Now we're ready to understand the, at a basic level, the processes of cell communication that enable multicellular organisms especially to have organs and cells and tissues that can talk to each other in molecular terms and orchestrate the appropriate functioning of the entire organism. So especially when we talk about multicellular organisms, cell communication becomes a very, very important subject. And defects in these processes of cell communication can lead to various pathologies, including that of many cancers. So if you want to understand cancer, the understanding of the basic biology of cell communication is essential. So that's where we're going to spend a little time now over the next few parts of this lecture on cell communication. In general terms, then, we can refer to cell communication as the ability of a cell to sense signals coming from other cells, and these are usually mediated by receptors. So if we talk about the components of cell communication, we need to talk about a signal, usually extracellular signal, that can either be hydrophilic and be bound by a receptor that is embedded in the plasma membrane, or it can be hydrophobic, which can enter the cell directly by passing through the cell membrane, the phospholipid bilayer. In the case of hydrophilic signals or ligands, those are bound by receptors that, again, are integral membrane proteins that are embedded in the plasma membrane, and that can somehow, in one fashion or another, communicate the binding of a signal to an appropriate signal transduction pathway by which the signal is transduced into an appropriate cellular response. In the case of hydrophobic ligands, they also must bind to receptors that are responsible for activating a pathway that will transduce that signal into an appropriate cellular response. So the elements then of cell communication of the types we're talking about are a signal, a receptor, a signal transduction pathway, and then the appropriate cellular response. And so it's important that we study all of these processes in some little bit of detail, at least in this course, and that's where we're going with this series of lectures. Now we can divide the type of cell signaling that occurs between cells into various types based on the distances involved in the cellular signaling. So first of all, we have direct contact or juxtacrine, what we call juxtacrine signaling. Juxtaposed means to be very close together. So in direct contact, cells are actually, the molecules on the surface of cells, I should say, are actually in contact with one another. And there are, excuse me, there are several types of direct contact that we'll be studying later. The next type of cell communication that we're talking about is called paracrine signaling, in which the signaling cell that is secreting a signal and the receiving cell, which is receiving that signal, are fairly close together on the order of several hundred microns. They're usually within the same tissue or in nearby tissues. So that is called paracrine signaling when the signaling and receiving cells are fairly close together. Next, we move to endocrine signaling, in which the signals are sent and received over long distances. For example, a hormone that is secreted into the blood by an endocrine gland produces that hormone that can travel long distances throughout the bloodstream and be received by a target tissue that is really quite distant from the signaling tissue. So endocrine signaling, we usually think of as hormonal signaling, and that occurs over much longer distances in a multicellular organism. And synaptic signaling is a very special type of paracrine signaling. It occurs over very, very short distances and involves the release of a neurotransmitter from a presynaptic cell that is received by receptors on the postsynaptic cell. And that reception is usually transduced either into an increased electrical excitability, which causes the postsynaptic cell to fire an electrical signal, or in an inhibitory case, a decreased electrical excitability, which inhibits that postsynaptic neuron from firing and sending a signal. So neurotransmitters can either be inhibitory or excitatory, and they are released by the presynaptic cell and are received by the postsynaptic cell after traversing a very narrow, what we call synaptic gap or synaptic cleft. So these in general terms then are the four major types of cell-cell communication that we're going to consider. Now, let's continue with looking at a special type of catalytic event that is very important in the transduction of cellular signals, and that is phosphorylation and dephosphorylation of proteins. Proteins, once manufactured, although we haven't covered the synthesis of proteins in great detail yet, you know that proteins are manufactured by the translation of messenger RNAs by ribosomes, and long sequences of amino acids are constructed, which can fold into various three-dimensional shapes based upon their primary amino acid sequence. And serine, or threonine, that's ser or THR amino acid, serine or threonine, are common amino acids found in most proteins. And there is an OH group on these serine or threonines, which can be targets for phosphorylation. And kinases are a special class of enzyme that phosphorylate target proteins. So, for example, a serine-threonine kinase will take an ATP, will catalyze the removal of a phosphate from ATP, thereby producing ADP, and will phosphorylate serine or threonine target amino acids on target proteins. So we end up with a phosphorylated protein. Now, imagine that you are in a comfortable position, some comfortable position, someone puts a heavy object in your hand, maybe a bowling ball or something. That's the equivalent of phosphorylating a protein. You're adding a large molecular moiety, a large molecular functional group to a protein which previously did not have it through the action of a kinase. And this can change the conformation of a protein and influence its activity. Phosphorylation can either make a protein active that was previously inactive, or it can inhibit a protein that was previously active and block its activity. So phosphorylation can activate or deactivate a protein's function. And therefore, the phosphorylation of proteins is a very important, what we call post-translational modification. The modification of the protein is occurring after the protein has been translated from a messenger RNA. And that modification, that post-translational modification, is affecting whether or not the protein is functional or not. Now, kinases, which whenever you see the word kinase, you think of target protein phosphorylation. A kinase enzyme is an enzyme that phosphorylates target proteins. And serine threonine kinases phosphorylate target proteins at serine or threonine residues. Well, there are also kind of a yin to the yang of kinases. There are phosphatases. And phosphatases do catalyze the opposite reaction. They dephosphorylate target proteins, removing a phosphate group as an inorganic phosphate and producing a non-phosphorylated protein at serine or threonine residues. So on one hand here we have serine or threonine kinases, and then the serine or threonine phosphatases counteract the effect of kinases. And for any particular protein that is capable of being phosphorylated, is a target for phosphorylation or is a target for dephosphorylation. There exists a kind of a phosphorylation state in the cell in which there's a balance between the phosphorylated and the unphosphorylated states. And the disruption of that homeostasis, the disruption of that balance, can lead to overactivation of that protein, which can elicit a cellular response. Or alternatively, inhibiting the activity of a protein can inhibit or can elicit rather a cellular response. So, as we've said, phosphorylation can either activate or inactivate a protein. Often it activates a protein, but not always. And then dephosphorylation, then, by the same token, can theoretically activate or inactivate a protein. That doesn't mean destroy the protein. Inactivation here simply refers to the functioning of that protein in some pathway or some role in the cell. And just as we've looked at serine or threonine kinases and serine or threonine phosphatases, there are serine, or there are rather tyrosine kinases or tyrosine phosphatases. And as the name implies, these enzymes are involved in either phosphorylating target tyrosine amino acids on proteins or dephosphorylating those tyrosines, removing a phosphate group from those target tyrosine residues within a protein. So we have two major classes of kinases and phosphatases, the serine-threonine kinases and phosphatases, and the tyrosine kinases and phosphatases. And it's very important to understand these, the role of kinases and phosphatases, because we will see that their role, they become very important enzymes in transducing many cell signaling events. So phosphorylation events are very important in phosphorylating, or in rather, phosphorylation or dephosphorylation is very important in terms of regulating the response of cells to signals, as we will see. What I'd like to address now are different types of receptors for cellular signals. So let's look at some different classes of those. First, let's consider the ion channels that actually receive extracellular signals, in some cases neurotransmitters, that cause the channel to open. And that opening allows the facilitated diffusion of ions down a concentration gradient. So for example, a sodium ion channel might be linked to or might bind a extracellular neurotransmitter that would cause that sodium channel to open, and sodium being at a higher concentration outside the cell than inside the cell due to the action of the sodium potassium pump that we've talked about will flow through the ion channel pore and into the intracellular environment. So sodium will flow down its concentration gradient when sodium channels open up. And certain receptors are indeed sodium channels, and they, when they receive signal, they change their conformation so as to form a pore which ions can flow, through which ions can flow. And I'm going to show you one example of a ion channel to give you an idea of what's involved, and this happens to be a potassium channel. And that's where we'll pick up with, in the next segment of this lecture, a detailed look at the structure of a potassium channel.